what I'm going to do today. We had another cancellation, and I'm in charge of making sure there's no gaps in the brown bag lunch. And because I'm going overseas next week, I'm giving a couple of presentations, one in Oxford, one in Finland, actually the same one. And rather than to give one of them, I'll be giving is an overview of self-concept research and so forth. But another one is just sort of highlights of the things I'm doing. And it's supposed to stimulate people that are listening who might be interested in collaborating on some of the kinds of things that I'm doing. So I'm using you as a guinea pig to look at that presentation. Now, if the presentation is a little bit longer, probably much too long as most of my presentations are, but I'll skip some of it because you don't actually need to know who I am. You know who I am, and you know that I publish lots of Google Scholar citations, and the citations are still going up, and that's a word map. The only thing that is really important on that word map is that there's the substantive and the methodological, and the focus of really what I'm looking at in this presentation is that all of the stuff that I do is sort of a cross between substantive and methodological. It's a synergy between the two of them. And if Phil Parker were here, he would tell you how he hates that terminology, substantive methodological synergy. But because I am sort of created that as a niche area for myself, I use it a lot. And the things I'm talking about here, it'll be obvious where they fit in to that. There's also a quick little overview of where we are. Australia, Sydney, Strathfield, and we'll still even be at Strathfield for a while longer, so it's not out of date, and even showing where my office is. Okay, so in the presentation that I'll make, I'll give a very quick little overview of the structure of self-concept that's underlying my research. Figure A is the original Shableson model, where there was a multi-dimensional hierarchical notion of self-concept. There's general self-esteem at the top, and academic is on the left, and that's divided into academic self-concept and specific subjects. And on the non-academic side, the social, emotional, physical. And then figure B is the Marsh-Shableson revision of that. And when we did the early research, subject-specific components of self-concept were so highly differentiated that it didn't make sense to talk about a global academic self-concept. And so we proposed two higher-order academic self-concepts, the math and verbal. And that's turned out to be quite heuristic in that all sorts of stuff has come from that. And I'll talk about a little bit of that in this presentation. One of the things that I've recently done is try to put together the different models that I've looked at into a single model and to see to the extent that I can come up with a single model and a single statistical model that incorporates all of these. The internal-external frame of reference model is looking at the relationship between math and verbal achievement and how they're related to math and verbal self-concept. And the quite remarkable finding from that one is that the verbal achievement has a negative effect on math self-concept, and math achievement has a negative effect on verbal self-concept. And that's that notion of dimensional comparison. So how good my self-perception of how good I am in one subject is related to how positive I feel about myself in another subject. So in my best subject, I have a good self-concept. In the worst subject, I have a poor self-concept. Whether or not I'm relatively good in everything or relatively not so good in everything. So that's that iterative type of process. And that spawned off a whole series of studies, even a new theoretical model, dimensional comparison theory. The reciprocal effects model is saying that academic self-concept and achievement are reciprocally related over time, such that each is a cause and effect to the other. So this is the temporal comparison. So my academic self-concept in a given subject area is a function of not only how good I am in that subject, but whether that whether I'm getting better or worse in that subject. So that's a internal comparison process. And the third one is the big fish, little pond effect. And that's...
Can you spell it there?
Little pony effect. Promise me a pony.
Okay, and that's the social comparison effect. That's the one that says that if you go to an academically selective school, your academic self-concept goes down. And so these have been fairly distinct areas of research. The internal-external frame of reference model is looking at the individual student, so it's usually single level. The multi-level is normally ignored. It's typically cross-sectional, so it's not longitudinal. The reciprocal effect model is usually looking at the individual student. It's clearly longitudinal, but usually only two waves, so not very longitudinal. And the big fish, little pond effect is typically looking at a single subject, whereas obviously the IE model is looking at multiple subjects. And the particular aspect of the big fish, little pond effect is that it's a multi-level model. So it's looking at contextual effects. So working with German colleagues, working with a German database called PAMA, I put together all of these models into a single statistical model. So the statistical model that underpins this diagram provides tests of all three of those. So I can test all of them simultaneously with one data set and one statistical model and integrate. And the integration of them provides some new interesting predictions that wouldn't come out of any one of them considered separately. So in this model, the IE model, the pass from year four grades to self-concept in years, these pass support or positive for math grades and negative for German grades. So that supports the IE model. And these were pretty consistent over time. The reciprocal effect model was a math achievement. Had consistent positive effects. Math achievement and self-concept had consistently positive effects, so the reciprocal effects over time. The big fish, little pond effect, we looked at school average achievement that was based on the track, based on year four primary school grades, and also test scores at the start of high school, and each of them gave that. And the developmental equilibrium, which is a new aspect of this, showed that these effects were consistent over all 5 years of the mandatory secondary school system. So the integration highlights the robustness and support of the adolescent period, the complementarity and counterbalancing strengths and weaknesses of the three academic self-concept models. It results in some new theoretical, developmental, and substantive implications for some new things that happen at the intersection of each of these models. Okay, so that's one area that I'm working on. The second area is a recent publication on looking at the cross cultural generalizability of the year in school effect. Let's see, don't I have another slide? Okay, I'm running right in. Okay, so with the PISA data, they have an age, everybody is 15 who takes the PISA test in all the different countries. But within each country, that means that there's different year groups. So I can look at the modal year group, but some kids are younger, are in lower grades, some grades are in higher grades. So what I was arguing was that you can look at this along the lines of the big fish, little pond effect. So in the big fish, little pond effect, if you go in with a more advanced group, your self-concept goes down. Here I'm arguing if you're accelerated, so that you're with in older, you're with older kids who have had more academic background or whatever, your self-concept will go down. If you're old for your group, your academic self-concept will go up. And so these are both based on a social comparison process, but they're really quite different underlying processes. So let me reiterate what relative year in school is. The actual year in school that you're in, the difference between that and the average year of school of 15-year-olds in the same country. So the positive values indicate that you've been accelerated, you either started young or you skipped a grade, and negative values indicate that you've been retained. Either you started late or you repeated a grade. So the diagram, the design is sort of looking like this. So we've got lots of countries and lots of schools and lots of students. And the main independent variables that I'm looking at are the individual student achievement, the school average achievement, and then relative year in school. And my main dependent variable is math self-concept. And I've got potential mediators and some additional outcomes and so forth. But mainly I'm looking at those three variables. And here's sort of the graphs of those three variables, so that individual student achievement has a positive, mostly linear effect on math self-concept. That's not surprising. On the right, we've got, there's a typo there too. On the right, we're supposed to have school average student math achievement, and that has a negative effect on math self-concept. In the middle is the new one, looking at relative year in school, that has a negative, you can see, yes, okay. That's a negative linear effect of relative year in school. And the third is the big fish little pond effect, the negative linear effect of school average achievement. This is the caterpillar plot. So the blue line is no effect. And this is showing that for the 41 countries in this round of PISA, there were no countries where the relative school effect was positive, and similarly for the big fish little pond effect, there were no countries. So it varies from country to country to some extent, but there's none that the effects are positive. So in terms of cross-cultural generalizability, that's kind of remarkable to get something that is somewhat paradoxical to look at that. Now, what I did then was then said, okay, let's try and unpack the relative year and school effect. And so I considered separate variables, looking at starting age, whether kids had been retained, kids being retained is a particularly controversial one, and whether kids started early and whether kids were accelerated. All four of those variables had some effect, but all four of those variables were wiped out by, their effect was wiped out by relative year in school. And so what I'm arguing is that the relative year in school is the critical variable, and it explains all the variance that can be explained by starting early, starting late. So starting early has a negative effect, starting late has a positive effect, being retained has a positive effect, being accelerated has a negative effect, and all four of those can be explained in terms of relative year in school. Strong theoretical basis based on the big fish little pond effect, cross-cultural generalizability, robust, broadly generalizable. We also looked at a variety of other variables, math anxiety, intrinsic, extrinsic motivation, cooperative, competitive, orientation, learning styles, and mathematics. There were the effects were typically smaller than they were for math self-concept, but there were no positive effects of relative year in school on any of these variables. Okay, so the next study was looking at the long-term effects of repeating a year in school. So that's really a controversy. That's really the more interesting, that's a particularly interesting aspect of that earlier paper, because the accepted wisdom, I love that term, I use that as a straw man all the time. The accepted wisdom is that having kids repeat a grade is bad. And in particular, people argue that kids' self-concepts will be ruined if they are told they failed and have to repeat a grade. And so that's my big fish, little pond effect argues the opposite. And when I was thinking about this, I also came up with another interesting theoretical perspective, and this is looking at mastery learning. So the mastery learning perspective is that if you give kids long enough, they can master the material. And the problem that we have with our school system is that we don't give kids long enough to master the material. And then we have the Matthew effect that comes in. And the Matthew effect says that if there's a gap between you and what you should be doing or what other kids are doing that's at a given level, that gets bigger over time. The Matthew effect is from the Bible, the rich get richer, the poor get poorer. As I'm using it here, if you have a child in year seven or whatever that hasn't mastered basic math skills and you promote them on to the next year group, they're not going to have learned those skills that they're supposed to have, and they'll be even further behind. So that that gap between where they are will get bigger over time, whereas one way of giving them added time is to have them do the year group over again. Okay, so it's a fairly complicated design, but it's quite an interesting one. So here we have, this is five ways of data. These are the five compulsory years of secondary education in the German system. And so at each year group, or at each wave, there's a certain number of kids that repeat, that have to repeat the year. And so we've got five natural intervention groups, if you will. These are the kids that are having to repeat the grade. We've got quite a powerful set of covariates, but also for this group, we have four ways of follow-up data. For this group, we have one wave of pretest data and three ways of follow-up, and so on and so forth. So it's a very interesting design with incredibly powerful covariates. Now, the results show that the effects of retention were positive on just about everything. The most positive effects were school grades, particularly math school grades, which was the focus. You look at that effect size, that's an effect size of one standard deviation. Relative to educational research, that's a huge effect size. That's unbelievable. And especially for something that the accepted wisdom says is bad, this is said it's got a huge effect. Now, the other thing that's quite interesting is that that effect is maintained over lag. So you might expect that the first year the students repeat a grade, because they've already covered that material again, they're at a big advantage. But in fact, those increased school grades are maintained over subsequent waves. So there's no diminishing of those of that improved school grades. Self-concept, self-efficacy, math anxiety, reverse scored are all quite big effects. The only effect that is negative, it's a relatively small one, is the math standardized test. But even this is a tricky one to interpret, because the typical way that the research is done is that if I repeat year seven, then the following year, all the other kids go on to year eight, and me and all those other kids are tested on a year 8 test, which is material that I haven't been taught, and they've all been taught. And so in that case, it goes down small, yeah.
Why are all the lag 4 effects bigger than the 2 and 3?
Let's see. Lag 4 effects is only, there's only one group that has lag 4 effects. Only the first group, whereas two groups have lag 3 effects and three groups have lag 2 effects.
Does that suggest repeating earlier might be better? Or
pardon?
Does that suggest repeating earlier might be even better than repeating later?
Let's see. That's at the end. And if you see, there's only one of them that's significant. And that's because the numbers, by the time you get out to lag 4, because it's only wave 1 that has a lag 4. So it's in the right direction, but mostly they're not significant, whereas most of the ones in the lag 1 that's a focus are. In any case, so if you test year 7 kids on a year 8 test on material they haven't been presented, they haven't been taught, they don't do so well, and that's a negative effect. But if you test them on year 7 material and compare them to year 7 students, or what the other group from before did when they were in year 7, they actually do better. So if you compare them, if you test them on the material relevant to what they've been taught, then even their test scores are better. So, consistent with operatory predictions, the school retention, repeating year of school had largely positive effects. A diverse set of 10 outcomes. The design was particularly strong. It featured 4 independent retention groups, and the results were consistent across the 4 different retention groups. The test of developmental invariance demonstrated the effects of retention, even controlling for covariates and pre-intervention outcomes were highly consistent across the potentially traumatic adolescent period. Obviously, results have important policy implications. Different school systems around the world, even within the same country, use diverse strategies in relation to school retention, apparently without fully understanding the implications of these policy practices in relation to a variety of psychosocial variables. So this is an example of a substantive methodological synergy that has some really important policy implications. The next one is sort of is putting together 3 paradoxes of self-concept research. 2 of them are related to what I've already talked about, and 1 of them is a new one. So we simultaneously looked at 3 paradoxes on academic self-concept formation within a single unifying frame of reference model. So the big fish little pond effect is being from countries where country average achievement was high provides an explanation for a paradox, what has been referred to as a paradoxical cross-cultural concept effect. Now, this was originally based on work by some American researchers that were comparing self-concept and achievement in the United States with East Asian countries, and they showed that the U.S. students had lower achievements but higher self-concepts, and they called it the paradoxical cross-cultural effect, and they came up with a whole variety of explanations as to that were reasonably specific to the Asian and U.S. culture. So here I'm testing whether that effect generalizes across, in this case, 68 different countries, rather all across the world. The second one is the big fish little pond effect, attending schools where school average achievement was high. The big fish little pond effect generalized over 68 countries. It was consistent over OECD, non-OECD countries, high and low achieving schools, and high and low achieving students. And then the third one is the year of school effect relative to age, which is the one that I've already talked about, that unifies different literatures for associated negative effects for starting school at a younger age, and acceleration skipping classes, and positive effects for starting school at an older age, academic redshirting, and repeating a grade. So here's the diagrams. This is similar to the one that I showed for an earlier piece of study. The final one on the right is the negative effect of country average achievement. So that says that at a given level of achievement, if you're in a country that does well, your self-concept is lower, and if you're in a country that does poorly, that your self-concept is higher. And that's a fairly substantial effect, and that provides at least part of the explanation for what has been referred to as the cross-cultural self-concept paradox. And this is the results showing that the effects are pretty consistent. The effect, let's see, what's the first one? So the effects of individual achievement are positive, and that effect is pretty consistent across country. The negative effect of school average achievement is negative, and that's quite consistent across countries. And the negative effect of year in school, it's smaller, but it's consistent, and there's no country where that has a positive effect. In many countries around the world, high ability students are increasingly being taught in academically selective schools, but our results imply that these may not be optimal environments. So we can talk about some of the implications of this, but some of them are fairly obvious at least. Okay, the last study is a study that Teresa is doing with me. And this is looking at something called phantom effects. Now we've got an interesting paradox. We have the reciprocal effect model, and that says that academic self-concept and achievement are reciprocally related. Higher achievement leads to better self-concept, and better achievement leads to higher self-concept, and good self-concept leads to higher achievement. Then we have the big fish little pond effect that says that being in a high ability school has a negative effect on academic self-concept. So the question is what's the effect of being in a high ability school on achievement? If you put the first two dot points together, it would suggest it would maybe be negative. However, it's widely believed with some empirical support that school average achievement has a positive effect on achievement, something that we've referred to. And we're not happy with this terminology at all, but what we've come up with is a positive peer spillover effect. So that says that if the peers around you are bright, then that has a positive effect on your academic achievement. Now there's another set of studies. Phil Parker has done some of this, and then there's some other research, and we're working on some more of this, that is looking at another angle of the same thing. And what they're doing is they're taking all the PISA studies from the beginning and looking at countries that have been in all the PISA studies reasonably consistently, and looking at so some countries become more more stratified in terms of academic achievement, like Australia is becoming more stratified. The variation between schools is becoming larger over that time, whereas some other countries are becoming less stratified over time. So within any given year group the more stratified the country, the achievement is, and the more stratified the schools are, the lower the average achievement. But we were also able to show that over time, that countries that became more stratified, like Australia, their average achievement went down, and countries that became less stratified over time, their average achievement went up. So Germany, although they're still very stratified, they become less stratified over time because of some of the PISA results, and their achievement is going up. So what we're able to do is to, we've already talked about the reciprocal effect model, the big picture of the pond effect, country level tracking strategies. This is what I just talked about, that countries with explicit tracking.
Another spelling error.
Well, we got
tracking strategies.
Huh?
Spelling error.
Okay, good.
Tacking.
You have to check things out. Yeah, is it?
Tacking a nautical term?
Okay, so countries with explicit tracking policies tend to have lower levels of achievement. So putting all these together, why is it that there's support for academically selective schools having higher academic achievement? Yeah.
Did you say, how did you measure if the country was increasing or decreasing tracking?
We looked at ICCs over the different waves of PISA.
Oh, so how similar people were versus different,
well,
within a class?
How much variation there is a function of school.
Nice.
And if the variation, school to school variation goes up, we're saying that's increased tracking. And if school to school variation goes down, that's decreased tracking.
That's cool.
And we also use the Gini index.
Yes, there's different ways of looking at it. Yeah. Okay, so and trying to present this in a short period of time is difficult, but one of the key issues here is that the selective school mostly ignores pre-existing differences, and non-experimental research can never control all pre-existing differences. So there's always pre-existing differences. The only way that you can control those, maybe even, is through random assignment. So without random assignment, there's always a potential of pre-existing differences, no matter how many covariates you have. And in this case, the pre-existing differences will almost always be biased in terms of the academically selective schools. Any achievement differences that are pre-existing that aren't controlled will advantage academically selective schools. Yeah.
Is that because there's less variation in academic schools? There's less.
No. It's just that they start off brighter, and there's lots of reasons why they're, and you can never control for all the reasons. I mean, they're a self-selected group.
There's only been one randomized control trial.
Well, this was a 1990 meta-analysis, so at that point there was only one. But it's pretty hard to randomly assign kids to school and follow them up over a long term. So this is a really neat meta-analysis that was showing. This meta-analysis showed that academically gifted students in gifted classes had better achievement than gifted students in regular classes, and the effects went down with the number of variables that they controlled. It was really crude. It wasn't even what they controlled, just the number of control variables. And there was a monotonic decrease. So the one random assignment they didn't have, there were no significant differences at all. The other one that's a really tricky one is this issue of sampling error. And what we were able to, if your a measure of achievement has unreliability, which it always does, that unreliability will mean that the individual achievement is less related to the subsequent achievements. So, but what happens with the multi-level is that variance that should be explained at the individual student level gets absorbed into the school level. And so the school level is positively biased. And we were able to show this. We took a regular multi-level study and we introduced random noise at L1 to simulate what happens when the reliability goes down. So nothing happened. So this was real data. And in that study, the effects of individual achievement went up, went down, and the positive effects of school average achievement went up. And so we were able to show that if you use appropriate doubly latent multi-level models that we've developed through our research in this area, that we can control for that effect. And so what Teresa is doing along with the rest of us working on this, we've got the US kindergarten database that is huge nationally representative sample with measures in kindergarten, first, third, and fifth grade. And here we've been able to show that if we control for pre-existing differences from the kindergarten area, and we control for the measurement error using the doubly latent model, that the effects of school average achievement on subsequent achievement are negative, and the effects of school average achievement on subsequent self-concept are negative. Those effects, the achievement effect moves from positive to negative when we control for these phantom effects. The big fish little pond effect moves from somewhat negative to more negative, and at least part of the negative effect of school average achievement on subsequent achievement can be explained in terms of the big fish little pond effect. So this provides a nice resolution for the theoretical problem that we were looking at, what this paradox of why school average achievement has such a negative effect on self-concept and seems to have a positive effect on achievement.
Just a quick kind of trying to get my head around why that would be happening. Is it because the there's a bias in terms of the amount of unreliability at the level one versus level two? Are the school levels, if you didn't take into account measurement, they're just more reliable generally because
the school average is an average of a whole
everything.
Bunch of scores.
So it has a bias to be more reliable with imperfect measures.
Yeah.
I understand. Yeah.
Okay, so obviously this has all sorts of implications, and this is still fairly early days because we're looking at some other databases to see if we can generalize. But this is a really big major. This is the major U.S. database for young kids, and these results have also been replicated in a large-scale U.K. study that one of my PhD students did when I was at Oxford. So there certainly is some generalizability, and also suggests that a lot of the systematic reviews and meta-analysis that don't take into account these phantom effects that we're talking about may be dubious. And so at the very least, those have to be incorporated as control variables when you're doing meta-analysis. And I mean, that's part of the problem with the meta-analysis, is that if there's a common methodological flaw that is generalized across most of the studies in the meta-analysis, then the meta-analysis is going to represent that bias. Okay, the next study is the temporal ordering of depression and bullying. Depression is depression a consequence of being bullied, or a selection factor that leads to being bullied or being a target of bullies? So obviously the answers to this have important implications. The sort of accepted wisdom is that if you're a victim of being a bully, you're going to get depressed, and that has long-term implications on depression and so forth. But the research basis for that is really weak, because mostly what's looked at is correlations. And So what we're looking at here is we've got a six-wave study looking at the effects of looking at the causal ordering of bullying, being a victim, and being in depression. There's some interesting findings. There's a reciprocal positive relationship between bullies and being a bully and being a victim. So bullies become victims and victims become bullies. So rather than being distinct, they feed off of each other. So victims subsequently become bullies. So that has important implications in terms of research and also the interventions, because oftentimes the interventions are focusing on bullies or focusing on victims, and it's clear that you have to look at both of them. But from the point of view of this study, the more interesting finding was that across the different waves, depression was a selection factor of being a victim, but being a victim did not increase depression above and beyond the pre-existing depression. So here we didn't have a reciprocal effect model. We had a one-way causal ordering where the direction of causal ordering was from depression to victim rather than from victim to depression. Now, whether or not those findings will generalize, I'm not arguing that so much that victim doesn't have an effect on depression. What I'm arguing is that the main finding here is that the main causal ordering is from depression to victim.
Those coefficients are pretty small, right, from bully to victim, and the other way around, 0.04, 0.43, they're significant, you're saying.
Yeah, it's a huge data set. Yeah. Oh, the dotted line, the solid lines are significant, the dotted lines are not.
Yeah, but small. Not very small.
Yeah.
It's not really going from bully to victim so much as being one person and having, like, it's not a category thing, is it? It's that these are individuals who have a certain amount of bulliness and a certain amount of victimness. Those things are related, isn't it?
Yeah,
what I'm trying to get at is, there are some kids that occupy a very sort of aggressive space where they can be both bully and victim, and there are other kids that just sit right outside that aggressive space.
Sure, and in the research that we looked at, we're saying that the majority of kids are neither bullies nor victims. For our intervention research, they're critical because they're the so-called innocent bystanders who, at least in the past, have passively reinforced the bullying behaviors.
Sorry, Eric.
Yes.
Is there a relationship between bullying and depression?
Yeah, they're positively related.
Okay.
Yeah. So that's why people jump to the conclusion that depression, that being bullied causes depression.
But that would be from bullying someone to...
Oh, no, wait a minute. There's no relationship between being a bully and depression. The causal order, there were no paths from those, no significant paths from that. Let's see. I think I'm going to go ahead and stop now because some of the other things are some of the more methodological ones.
You can have another study.
No. What's the typo there?
You have two N's.
N-N, integration.
It comes with age, is it?
Yeah. Okay. Some of the methodological things that I was going to is some of the stuff that we've done with ESIM, exploratory structural equation modeling. We've talked about that one here before. M Plus has come up with a new procedure for looking at invariance across multiple groups, and there's a new procedure that we've looked at in there. And then I've talked in this group before briefly about some of the stuff that we've done with the weighted average models, and how psychologists love weighted average models, but mostly they don't work if you actually rigorously test them. This has been a good exercise for me because it shows that I've got way too much material to present in an hour. But so I'll stop now. And are there any questions or any issues or? Yeah.
Yeah. It is probably not related to this, but it has to do with me looking at some of the data and related to the big fish, little pond effects. I loved them when you first talked to me about it in 1990s, early 1990s. It made sense, especially because of the effects of schools, attacking the selective school notions and that sort of stuff. But as I was looking at the piece of data, I had to look at the correlation between various self-belief values, the correlation between self-concept in PISA 2003 and anxiety is 0.67. In some of our data, the correlation is 0.74. I looked at one of the papers of Pajaris in the 1980s, and he was showing correlation between self-concept and anxiety 84. Now, these are very high correlations, and what I wonder as I was looking at that, and you know that I was looking at the cross-cultural differences, it looks as if there's the effect of the countries as you're talking about, negative correlation at the country level and positive correlation at the individual level. But that holds for self-concept, not for self, for anxiety at all. In anxiety, it goes the other way around. And but also,
if you reverse score the anxiety, that's not the case. Going to a selective school on every round of PISA has a positive effect on anxiety.
I'm talking about the countries. Across the countries.
Oh, okay.
Okay? Across the countries, anxiety and does not show that effect, and neither does self-efficacy. So it is that they are correlated, highly correlated, but one is showing that effect, the other one is not correlated. The other two are not showing.
In the study that I presented here, where I have school average achievement and country average achievement and individual achievement, country average achievement had the predicted effect on anxiety. Not the correlation. But when you control for individual school and country level achievement. Now, let me tell you something that I found quite fascinating. I've been working with a Swiss database that's called it's tertiary education going on to work. And they had a Rosenberg-type self-esteem. And one of the big problems with the Rosenberg is that they're positively and negatively worded items. And there's huge debates as to whether those are substantively different or not. And what they had done is that they took the negatively worded self-esteem items and called it global anxiety. And took the positively worded self-esteem items and called it self-esteem. So this issue that is... to what extent is anxiety the negative component of self-concept?
So I think it is introversion-extroversion kind of relationship, right? But then there is that paradox of not showing. And the other thing is...
But in this study, based on PISA 212, right. Country average achievement had... country average achievement, high country average achievement was associated with higher anxiety.
Yeah, maybe. I'll have to look at it.
Yeah.
The other thing that is puzzling and related to it is, as you know, PISA in a pilot study had anchoring effects, looking at it, and it is very clear that for self-concept anchoring effect is present. And it goes down for the country level. But what puzzled me is that they have 12 other variables that are showing exactly the same thing. At the individual level, positive correlation, country level, negative correlation. But they cannot be explained in terms of comparison with them. For example, teachers' classroom management is showing the same effect as a self-concept. But there are about 11 more that are looking at. I find that very interesting.
This country level achievement effect is related to that. Yeah, and I haven't quite figured out that. The pieces drop that.
Drop what?
The anchoring.
Well, they have a pilot study and then it is available. That's what I'm talking about.
Yeah, but what I'm saying is that based on that pilot study, they didn't follow up on it because they didn't know what it meant.
Yes, because it meant all sorts of things.
Yeah.
I found that the first thing you could learn was about how we make up a sense of self-concept from three comparisons with ourselves in other spaces, with ourselves in an earlier time, and with others. Is that limited to children, the researcher, or, I mean, do all three of those extend into adulthood, or, and here's...
Just think of yourself.
Yeah, but I think it gets less, like, I compare myself less to others than I once did, and I...
Maybe.
Yeah. but I think I compare myself to my own internal sort of standard more than I once did, and my own past more than I once did. Am I just making that up, or is there any evidence to suggest that?
I would guess that it's harder to pin down as you get older. I mean, in the school it's easy because we've got the school as a context and so forth. Here it gets a little harder, but I was clearly told when I gave my big fish little pond effect at Oxford that many of the Oxford academics felt like small fish. They said if I were at another university, I would be a major superstar. And outside of Oxford, I'm considered an eminent researcher. And in Oxford, I'm nothing special.
Yeah, I'd say that actually proved the exception that proves the rule. Academics are so ego obsessed that they probably carry on their childhood.
And you don't think you get that in athletes?
Oh, look, I'm sure, well, that's naturally competitive, but on the whole, the developmental trajectory is to grow out of those sorts of comparisons.
Well, this is the first time I put the three of them together.
That's brilliant.
And I'm quite sure that all three of those frames of reference are operational across the developmental period, but I would be loath to say that what the relative weight is of them.
You've presented a wealth of data about averages and also shown cross-cultural generalizability. Mm-hmm. I'd be interested to know about individual differences.
There's nothing that moderates it, no individual differences that moderate it to an extent that's anywhere near the size of the big fish little pond effect. And we've looked at dozens of individual differences, and let me go ahead. For several years I went around and I said, if anybody comes up with an individual difference that moderates it, I would take them out to dinner and I've lost it. What's the personality variable when you're so egocentric? Narcissism. And so somebody came up and showed that narcissism moderated the big fish little pond effect, but even that wasn't a huge effect. I'm sorry, I've interrupted you. Have you got a favorite one that you want to try?
I'm not sure I'm asking the question quite the same way. What I want to know is there a subset of kids who actually flourish? Because I'm much more interested in flourishing than in self-concept or performance. Mm-hmm. Is there a subset of kids who flourish when they're accelerated or put into a selective school? And if so, who are they? What do we know about them? You know, I'm not so interested in their self-concept. I want to know if they're flourishing, if they're engaged, excited, you know, got good relationships, you know, happy to wake up every morning.
Okay. most of those effects, I can say overall, are negative. And whether there's a subset. Now, the way that I've looked at this is I said, are there individual student variables that moderate this effect?
This effect being
the negative effect of school
on self-concept.
Yeah.
Yes, but what I'm saying is, let's put self-concept aside and let's talk about well-being.
Mm-hmm.
What do we know about well-being and big fish little ponds and acceleration?
Given that we can't measure well-being and we can't agree on what it is.
Working on well-being, we're
nearly
there.
Anytime I put anything up, it's shot down. But we've looked at the big fish, little pond effect generalizes to all sorts of psychosocial variables. But the interesting aspect that you raised is, are there any subsets of kids that are positively affected? And one would assume that there is. But I couldn't find any individual different variables that moderate. I mean, there were variables that moderated to an extent because I'm working with a piece of data, but there was nothing that had a substantial moderation effect.
Yeah. Maybe entity theorists?
Huh?
Like entity theorists versus growth theorists? No?
Yeah. Well, that's a starting point. Mastery learning, competitive.
What about, as you were talking about the repeating the year, I was wondering if the kid framed it as a learning, as an opportunity versus a failure. That would be a moderator, wouldn't it? Like, in some context, that would be framed as a failure, in some context, it would be framed just as another opportunity.
Dweck's stuff doesn't moderate it, and that's what she's trying to get at. Entity, incremental.
Yeah, no, maybe I'm not talking about incremental there, I'm just talking about is it a failure to repeat a year?
The variables that I've looked at that are related to that don't substantially moderate it. And I find it amazing. I find it amazing that it's so robust, because you would think that there would be moderators.
And I know that anecdotal evidence is, you know, not really evidence, but as someone who went to selective schools, I probably had lower self-concept than if I didn't. But my goodness, I was so engaged and so excited, and it was because of that I've ended up in academia. I just loved it. So it didn't matter that my self-concept was lower.
Same thing for me. At every level of education I've ever been at, I've been in just marginally in the top 10%, whether this was primary school or UCLA graduate school. And I thought competition was great. I love competition, and I always thrive in competition, and so it was a real eye-opener when my research kept saying that my personal experience didn't generalize.
But maybe we're looking at different outcomes. Maybe we're not, yeah.
Give me
the
an outcome.
The outcomes that we're talking about now are not the outcomes that are being measured in PISA.
You'd be surprised at how many You'd be surprised at how many things are being measured in PISA and different things. Certainly engagement.
Yeah.
Engagement has, school average achievement has a negative effect on engagement. And that's at least a little bit related to what you're talking about.
So the higher the school average achievement, the less engagement.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah, I can. And that's why it's paradoxical. Anybody else? Great, thank you very much.